Hello and welcome back to What Remains of Edith Finch. It's been an interesting ride thus far. This might be the last episode. I don't know. It's definitely a lot more than I thought it was going to be for like what I paid for it. And I don't know. I don't really know what I was expecting when I went into this, so let's just keep going.
But looking back on it now.
Oh.
If she told me there was going to be so much climbing, I never would have come when I was 22 weeks pregnant.
Baby. This is not going to end well. Baby! That makes sense, like, in the last episode, like, when she was talking about, I'm sure you're just as confused as I was, or I am. I was wondering if she, like, had a child. She's 17. 22 weeks, that's 7 months? 6 months. Not good at math. Casual reminder. This is such a bizarre game.
I never met Grandpa Sam, but I think he and my mom had a lot in common.
Baby. Baby bump. Bird feeder.
They were both pretty intense.
I'd say so. I love Grandpa Sam. I already love him.
Sam spent his life shooting photos, but Mom said he got nervous being in front of the camera. I guess we're all afraid of something.
Oh yeah, he's the one that had the little photography studio in the walls.
Dawn, I promise, you'll never forget this weekend.
Yes, sir.
These memories are gonna last a lifetime.
Mm-hmm. What? Am I gonna have to...
Perfect.
It's gonna rain the whole weekend, isn't it? Please just take the damn picture.
Hey, language.
I will never forget this weekend, Dad.
That's the spirit. Okay, got it.
I'm gonna take some pictures, okay?
Just be careful. The camera's older than you are.
You're right, Dad. It's starting to clear up. Still freezing, though.
This is so cool.
Definitely should not have drunk all that coffee.
Hmm. Hold still while I take...
Hey!
That's a keeper.
I'm just saying, I'm not always gonna be here, Dawn. You'll need to remember this stuff, if you want to survive.
I'll be fine, Dad.
You know who else thought he was going to be fine?
Some guy who died.
Dawn, I'm being serious.
I know, Dad. You're always serious. Doesn't being out here make you want to chill out?
Well, to tell you the truth, I haven't been out here in 20 years. Dawn, don't you think you could find something more interesting to photograph? Last time I was with my brother Calvin. Man, that was a great trip. Your grandpa Sven taught us how to fish, how to build a fire.
Dad!
Good eyes, Dawn. Before you take the shot, let me get a picture of him.
Dad, I...
Just breathe. Turn on.
Oh, my bad.
Let me get behind you.
Do I have to do this?
Dawn, you don't have to do anything. But if you want to survive, you need to be strong. Keep yourself squared up. Great shot, Dawn!
Ooh!
I'm proud of you, Dawn. Always remember that, okay?
Dad, it's twitching. I think
that's
it's
totally
so...
normal, Dawn. Just focus on the camera. Try not to think about...
Dad!
Of all these stories, that's the one I wish most that my mom had told me.
What? Close the book. Oh my gosh.
Instead of hiding from death, Sam seemed to go out of his way to meet it.
Did he stuff the cat? Can I have that? This is definitely not what I thought it was going to be at all. There's an axe right there, too. Jeez, where all did you keep axes, dude? Oh. More of this. Meal ready to eat. Oh, that makes sense for Grandpa's. Y'all saw that, right? Ghosty goo?
After Sam died, my mom and Edie got really close. They'd both lost a lot.
Yeah, I'd say so. These people just, like, keep memorials up of their deceased children? Wait, I wasn't done reading that. Sorry.
Dear Kay. Do you remember the way Gregory used to laugh when he thought he was alone? Like something funny was happening, but only he could see it.
Oh my God, I'm a little fat baby.
The rest of us don't.
Hold on, sweetie.
You're gonna leave a baby in the bathtub?
Sam, I told you I don't want to talk right now.
I wonder what he saw. What his world was like.
Aha! Sorry about that, Gregory.
I know you did everything you could. Maybe if I hadn't called that night.
Damn it. Hold on, I don't want Gregory to hear this.
I wish he could have told us about the world he saw. There's so much I don't understand about Gregory, about everything.
This is weird.
What happened wasn't her fault. I'm sure he's happy. And he'd want you to be happy too. Good luck, Kay. Love, Sam.
Jeez.
Well, I can't imagine my mom ever writing poetry, and yet.
Gus had a mohawk? Could be a baby.
My mom moved up to the loft after her brothers died. At the time, it was as far away as she could get.
I still need to go back and read. Hello, sorry, I have to go back down and read. I love your boots, though. They're super cute. Let's go down. All right, let's do this.
A poem for Gus, who always said the wedding was a bad idea. Our father never hit us kids, at least not very hard, before the day my brother said with teenage disregard that he'd be dead before he'd see a wedding in our yard. Father made him come, of course, but Gus stood far apart, just flew his kite and bottled up the storm inside his heart.
This is so interesting. I am not good at flying this kite. Oh!
I tried to talk him out of it, but though he'd never met her, we don't need a stepmom, were the words that I
now pronounce you husband and wife. Make him cry.
Oh,
time for photos came, Dad ordered him to
come here.
But Gus declined, and as a sign, held up his middle finger. The wind picked up, and panicked geese appeared and quickly went. But all the humans did that day was go inside the tent. Buckets then, but no one seemed afraid that nature might destroy the tent our dad had crudely made.
This is really difficult.
Thunder sounded much too close and full of angry power. But all my father said to this was, make the music louder. I wish that I could truly say I thought about you on that day. Out there on the beach alone, just you, the wind, the sea, and foam. But I didn't. Until we found you.
Oh.
She never talked about him, but Mom told me once if I was a boy, they were going to name me Gus.
Okay, now we climb. Sorry to make you do this twice. Three times, technically. But I won't make you come down again. That should be high enough, right? Yep. So this is where your mom's at. Oh, pretty.
She spent a summer building houses in Calcutta, where she met my dad. Sanjay.
Oh, cool. That's it? That's all I get to know?
My mom moved to India a week after graduation and got a job teaching English. Lewis was born a year later. When my dad died, I don't think Mom knew where else to go. I'm sure Edie was happy to have her back. And to see kids in the house again. The house had to get a little bigger, but Edie was used to that. For a while, things were good. Almost normal.
Homeschooled. Lewis Rose.
But it didn't last.
I definitely want to homeschool them.
The beginning of the end was Milton's 10th birthday, when Edie gave him a castle. after Milton disappeared, the only thing he left behind was a room full of paintings.
It's paint. I was like, is that blood?
Huh. I think Edie was happy to finally have another painter in the family. Edith Finch in The Magic Paintbrush.
Come on.
Disappeared.
Disappeared. For me to click on up here, right? I have to stand exactly right here. Yes, I do. Okay. That makes sense.
Mom spent months searching for my brother. Then she sealed the doors.
What? Why?
Whatever Milton had found in the house, Mom didn't want it getting out. Mom definitely blamed Edie, but I think Lewis blamed himself.
Why would Lewis blame himself?
After he graduated, he just spent more and more time in his room. Until Mom got him a job at the cannery. Everyone always told me to stay out of Lewis's room. Except Lewis.
He's got a hookah in there. I wonder if her brother Milton is still alive. kind of like how, who was he? The one that was under the house. I wonder if he's still alive.
Lewis's room smelled very, very familiar. That part of him lived on.
Oh no, I didn't want to leave. I was just turning around. Get back in there. So it's not technically, I mean, it is a hookah, but you're not smoking, what is it? Oh crap. You're not smoking good kush, you're smoking some good stuff. And you just left it here.
Lewis and I spent a lot of time playing games together, but he was surprisingly bad at them. He died a lot.
Fireweed Road? It was fireweed! Dude, I was right!
Dear Mrs. Finch, as Lewis's psychiatrist, I can understand your desire for an explanation. As I see it, the trouble began in January, shortly after we convinced your son to seek treatment for substance abuse. Newly sober, I believe Lewis first noticed the monotony of his daily life. He kept working at the cannery. But he withdrew part of himself. In our sessions, I saw the same behavior. His mind began to... wander. I asked him to describe it.
I'm trying to do two things at once, not get my hand cut off.
He said he started small. Imagining a labyrinth. He'd feel his way about. Then something moved. Bats. And toads. Things that have not names.
Okay.
He knew it was all in his head. But he took it very seriously. I had hoped he'd find himself. But he found something more. I worried about him then.
Why?
Daydreaming at the cannery. I spoke with his boss. But he said Lewis had become a model employee. Methodical, tireless, focused. Like a whole new Lewis. So I let him go on. I even encouraged him. It seemed very promising at first. He told me he'd made a new friend. On the edge of a city he named Lewis Topia. He built the city up slowly, brick by brick. Then he made musicians.
This is really difficult to do. Stuck behind some doors.
And songs for them to play. He talked about starting a band. And he was always humming something. Every day his imagination grew stronger. He no longer spoke at the cannon. But his chopping was as reliable as ever. Then one day it struck him. All the cheering crowds, even the stones under his feet, were all in his imagination. So he could do whatever he wished. He held an election for mayor. And he won. They begged him to stay, but his mind was already wandering. It became a game for him.
This is getting increasingly difficult.
He'd conquer a city, then immediately push on. New Lewisville. St. Louis. He started drifting away from our reality. Minneapolis. Until one day he forgot to go home from the cannery. Even as his mother pleaded with him, part of Lewis kept sailing on. In Lewisburg, he heard rumors of a beautiful prince. Prince was on his own quest for...
Oh my god, absolutely rainbows, are you kidding me?
Radiant rainbows.
Oh my gosh. Yes. Oh no. Okay, cool.
He followed the sound of his... Silver harp.
It's getting harder and harder to hear the sounds of the cannon.
His chase led him to a golden palace east of the sun and west of the moon. Even then, his logic remained sound. He knew the world was all in his imagination. But he was so proud of having created it. In his own eyes, he'd become something greater than a king. For someone who'd never known success in the real world, I think it was overwhelming. And then it struck him that the real Lewis was not the one chopping salmon, but the one climbing the steps of a golden palace. My imagination is as real as my body, he told me. It was hard to argue with him. Began to forget the world we know. I think it pained him to remember Lewis, the cannery worker. He began to despise the man with a royal contempt. I still thought I could save him.
Oh.
Even after he said he was being crowned king over all the lands of wonder.
What?
The palace would be packed with his companions. Calico who'd insisted on advising him.
I'd take the advice of a Calico.
His prince waited, holding his crown. I think you know. Mrs. Finch, your son was a kind man who will be missed by all of us who knew him.
My brother was really cool. I wish you could have met him.
I'm gonna end this episode here. Holy crap, this continues to just unravel more and more layers, and that to me is absolutely fascinating. Thank you so much for watching. I really appreciate it. If you want to watch the episodes before this, there will be a link to the playlist down below. Thank you again so much for watching, and I will see you in the next video. Bye bye.